took a very dim view of Western liberal capitalism. And if you were to scan through the newspaper articles, magazines, etc., on a daily basis, there was at least one article talking about the pros of state-sponsored firms, state-sponsored enterprises, and why state capitalism may be thought about as a viable alternative to the traditional capitalism that we are so used to. So a couple of quotes to put things in perspective. The crisis of the Western liberal capitalism has coincided with the rise of a powerful new form of state capitalism, quote Economist 2012. State-owned enterprises are not just the answer to market failures, but also leading innovation in many emerging economies. So Petrobras in Brazil came up with this cost-effective, environment-friendly way of offshore oil drilling, which none of the private players could pursue. Similarly, when Lenovo acquired IBM, it forced the world to take notice. So this notion of state-sponsored firms started getting steam again after the crisis. So this is not just an emerging market phenomena. France set up a bank of public investment after the crisis to start picking up stakes in private firms on behalf of the government. So they are sponsoring startups and they are buying stakes in existing private enterprises. And Germany has done something similar. In OECD countries alone, the total employment by state-owned entities is 6 million with a market size of over $3 trillion. So this is not just among popular press. Even academics and policymakers have been debating over this. So this is a quote from a policy piece by Acemoglu and Robinson, 2012. Avatars of liberal capitalism like the United States and the UK continued to perform anemically in 2012. While many Asian economies relying on various versions of dirigism have not only grown rapidly and steadily over the last several decades, but have also weathered recent economic storms with surprising grace. And they end the piece with a question, is it time to revise our economic textbooks? The economists ran an online debate among academics, debating the pros and cons of state-owned entities, and they ended their debate on a cautious note that it does seem to have promise, but the dangers might outweigh any advantages that state-owned entities have for the emerging countries. So what does theory say? So there are broadly two views of state ownership. The political views argues that state-owned entities will pursue political objectives at the cost of firm value maximization. The social view argues that they are there to cure market failures. And now there is an emerging hybrid view among academics. So Musacchio, for instance, has written a bunch of papers propagating this hybrid view, a new form of state capitalism that should be a viable alternative, and we should start thinking about that. So he argues that these are national champions who are now globally dominant players. The empirical literature, unfortunately, has a dim view. So if you were to compare state-owned enterprises with private firms on traditional measures of efficiency, stock returns, ROA, investment efficiency, on an average, in countries after countries, state-owned entities tend to perform private players. Now, while that is empirically established, the reasons for these inefficiencies is not. So if you talk to people, there will be a lot of anecdotal evidence thrown at you. So maybe there is political influence, maybe the corporate governance practices are not good in these firms, the incentive systems are not in place. But which of those channels and to what extent they contribute to inefficiency, there is absolutely no empirical paper on that. There is some large sample evidence on politically motivated lending by banks, but none whatsoever for non-financial state-owned firms. And this is where our paper comes in. So we want to understand how does politics affect real decision makings in state-owned firms, and in particular, we look at investment decisions. So thus far, as I mentioned, there is limited evidence of political influence in managerial decision making at these non-financial enterprises. So empirically, it's a challenge to argue that is political influence and work. So what is the counterfactual? Almost all the state-owned firms that you have today have always been under political capture or under political influence. So how would you measure what would change when there is no political influence? So if you compare private firms with state-owned firms, the problem is once they are privatized, a bunch of stuff changes. The corporate governance practices will change. There will be market discipline. New executives will be put in place. New employees will be put in place. So it would be difficult to pinpoint whether it is the lack of political influence that is leading to gains in efficiency. So what do we do in this paper? We look at elections as a source of exogenous variation in the timing of politician incentives. So the idea is that around elections, politicians have incentives to woo voters. And because of that, if they can, they will influence the investment decisions in these firms in order to attract voters. So we are very careful about identification in this paper, and we try our best to pin down causality. And elections is one of the ways we do it. And I'll talk about the other stuff as I get to the empirical part. So what are the questions, specific questions the paper asks? How do elections affect the timing of investments made by state-owned enterprises? Given that it does, are these investments in certain areas of strategic political importance? Now, even if that were true, it doesn't matter as long as these are not inefficient. So then we will look at some measures of inefficiency, market-based measures, stock price reaction in particular, to evaluate whether such investments destroy firm value. And finally, does the incumbents gain from influencing these investment decisions? So if I do not get time to go through all the results briefly, yes, state-owned entities announce a greater number of investment projects in election years. This is not driven by business cycles. So one could potentially argue that for whatever reasons, business cycles and elections are correlated. So elections tend to coincide with the peaks of business cycles. But if that were true, you should observe a similar effect for private firms, which we do not. By private firms, I mean non-state owned, so they can be publicly listed as well. Both political competition and authority seems to affect the location choice. So in election years, these state-owned entities, on an average, will announce a greater number of projects in swing districts. By swing, I mean where the election was competitive, so the margin of victory was lower, and in areas of federal ministers, party, top-ranking party officials, etc. And if you look at the market reaction to investments made by at least publicly listed SOEs, there is a negative stock price reaction. So in other words, the market sees them as negative NPV projects, so they are destroying value. Now I have to be cautious, I'm not making a social welfare claim here. From the perspective, the way at least we deal with in business schools, from the perspective of the firm, this is value destroying, and they seem to give an edge to the incumbents who are influencing these investment decisions. So thankfully, given I'm in India, I don't need to explain the data in detail. Our sample period spans 1995 to 2009. We include data on 4 national and 93 state elections during this period, and we look at both the impact of national and state elections. The state elections will be important empirically as well, and I'll discuss that in a bit. In each election for each constituency, we collect data from the Election Commission of India on the party winning in that constituency, the candidate, etc. We collate it together. One of the problems we face is that our investment data is at the district level, while the elections happen at the constituency level. So we aggregate the vote shares of the ruling coalition and the opposing coalition together and look at the difference in the vote share as a measure of political competition. So the SOEs in our sample can be both privately held or publicly listed. The key election variables that we would care about is, the independent variables are election year, which is just a dummy variable identifying years in which an election took place. Scheduled is a dummy variable identifying if the election was held as per schedule. So if an election was held and it was early or late, this would take a number of zero. Absolute margin, as I mentioned, is at the district level, we aggregate the vote share of the ruling coalition and the opposing coalition, and this is the difference in their vote share. So I call it absolute margin of victory, but it's practically absolute margin of victory or loss of the ruling coalition in that particular area. And I call a district to be swing or politically competitive if the margin of victory or loss is less than 5%. The way I measure political rank is by looking at whether there is a federal minister from that particular district or not. The financial data, again, this should be familiar to Indian audience, is from Center for Monitoring Indian Economy. So CAPEX is a database of project level investments made by firms. So this data set is unique across the world. So there is hardly any data set for any other country that has project level information, at least in the public domain. So this gives you the identity of the district, the location, the identity of the firm sponsoring the project. This gives you the day the project was announced, etc. And at least the location and the timing aspect of that is going to be very important for us, both to pin down causality of political influence and to measure efficiency. Financial data is from ProVest and GDP data is from IndiaStat. The investment variables we look at is number of projects announced in a particular district in a particular year, the proportion of central government projects to total projects announced and announcement dummy. So any issues regarding skewness in data that would not have a role to play in our results. We could also look at costs of the project announced. Now we only care about showing that there is political influence. The cost data is missing in CapEx for about 25% of the firms. We do robustness tests with that and it doesn't seem to make any difference. So as I discussed earlier, we are very careful about identification. So the election schedule in India is pre-specified, mandated to be held every 5 years. So a lot of issues regarding endogeneity get taken care of. Because it's pre-specified, no particular firm or in general, a party can influence the timing of elections. Most of the elections in our sample are anyways held as per schedule and were not early elections. We also use non-government firms as a placebo group. So as I mentioned earlier, any issues regarding potential business cycle effects should not matter. Or if it does, all the results that we show for state-owned entities should also hold true for private firms. So this is our placebo group. We use state elections. State elections offer a unique advantage. So state elections are staggered across time. So this allows us to control for year fixed effects or macroeconomic shocks. So our results will not be driven by those. We also use district fixed effects, and I'll discuss why, what advantage that offers in later tests. So we begin by looking at how do elections affect the timing of investments made by state-owned entities. Now the idea is fairly intuitive. The theoretical literature dates back a few decades. The idea is that around elections, either because voters are myopic or because for whatever reasons during other years, politicians cannot signal their ability, around elections, they will have a marketing effect and they will try to exhibit to voters that they are going to do something important for them. So maybe they are infrastructure projects. Maybe these are projects which help the local population get employment. So around elections, we expect that state-owned entities will announce a greater number of projects to woo in probably potentially in order to woo voters. So what do we get? The dependent variable is here is number of projects, is percentage. I also have dummy variables, but I'm not, for the purpose of the presentation, I will not show you that. So what does this mean? In election years, state-owned entities are announcing a greater number of projects. If you look at the non-government firms or the private firms, you do not observe anything, any effect. So this cannot be business cycle. In terms of economic significance, this represents a 17% increase in the number of projects being announced in election years. So you may be concerned that because some of the elections are held early, politicians may call early elections when the economy is doing well, so as to time it and maybe probably game the elections. So a simple way to deal with that issue is to drop all the early elections from a sample and our results are unchanged. You may not want to do that because it will reduce the sample size. What we do is use an instrumental variable approach, which others have, it's not our innovation, other people have done that. So schedule is an instrumental variable for the actual elections. It takes the value 1 if elections were held as per the 5-year schedule and 0 otherwise. It turns out to, not surprisingly, because most elections are held on time, it turns out to be a strong instrument. And so the early election does not seem to matter in our sample. So this is, we cannot do this with national elections because we have a smaller sample. There are just 4 elections in a sample period. With state, we have 93, so we have more power. And it doesn't seem to affect our coefficient variable. So endogeneity in the occurrence of early elections does not seem to have any impact on our results. So in percentage term, if you look at the state elections and the investments made by state SOEs, by state SOEs, I mean state-owned enterprises under the respective state governments, again, we see a 27.5% jump in the number of projects being announced during election years. And I should have been clear, during election year, I mean the fiscal year immediately preceding the election. So if elections are held in May 2009, the year from March 2007 to March 2008 would be the election year. So next we look at how do political variables affect the location of new investments. So these tests are again important for 2 reasons. One, it helps us disentangle these 2 theories of politically motivated targeting of resources. So one is the theory of tactical redistribution, which says that the incentives to woo voters are higher when incumbents face stiff electoral competition. And so why would that happen? Because in such swing areas, a small change in the vote share leads to large discontinuous jumps in the likelihood of victory. Or there is the core supporter model, which argues that to the extent politicians do not know the exact preferences of swing voters, they are like a gamble. But while your core supporter base, you know them, you can target them, and you can retain them. So you should offer meat, you should offer resources to your core supporter base. Empirically, we will look at what happens. Now, apart from being able to disentangle these two theories, it also offers another advantage. So we deal with referees all the time, and if the timing of elections were not exogenous enough for you, a skeptic could argue that state-owned entities and private firms are very different beasts. So for whatever reasons, they may have different business cycles, and the business cycles of PSUs or SOEs coincide with elections. Now, if that were to be the case, you should expect an increase in investments by state-owned entities across the board. Or in other words, a priori, you would not expect to see why more number of investments should happen in swing districts and not in other districts. Yeah, 5 minutes, okay. So we do a difference in difference analysis here. Essentially, we are comparing investments in swing districts in election years relative to non-election years with respect to non-swing districts, so non-competitive districts. So most of our meat comes from this result. So a larger number of investments are happening in swing areas as compared to non-swing areas, and in particular during election years. So in terms of economic significance, there is 35% jump in the investment made in these districts in election years only. So in non-election years, you do not find a difference. And so we also use district fixed effects in these tests. So again, as a skeptic, you could say maybe the voters in these districts are smarter. So they know that to keep the politician edge, you have to have a competitive election. And because they are smarter, maybe they attract investments. So what district fixed effects allow us to do is to look at within district variation. So we are comparing Mumbai city with itself. If it is swing with the counterfactual, what would have happened if it was not swing? So all of those issues are taken care of. So this is showing you the time series. This is not a part of the paper. We removed it because anyways, we thought there's a lot going on there. So what this shows is if you compare swing district to non-swing districts, in non-election, this is election. This is 1 year after, 2 years after, 1 year before, 2 years before. All of the peak is coming in the election year only. All of the other years are statistically indistinguishable from zero. If you look at private firms, this is flat. So there is no difference between swing and non-swing across the year, across the election cycle for private firms. So all of the effect is coming from SOEs and in certain kind of politically strategic areas. It's the same with the areas of ministers. The areas of ministers see a peak. So on an average, actually, the areas of ministers get more investments regardless of whether there is elections or not. But during elections, you see a jump in the number of investments being announced. Again, for the private firms, we do not see such an effect. It's largely flat. So I have a few moments. I would like to come to the main, one of the main important results. So far we have established, yes, there is compelling evidence of politicians motivating or influencing investments in these firms. But are these investments really value destroying? So we do a kind of an event study around the date of the announcement of the project. And again, this is why the CapEx data set is important, because it tells us the date of the announcement. So we look at the market reactions to projects announced by SOEs in election years, again doing a difference, comparing them to non-SOEs or private firms in election versus non-election years. On an average, for election years investments, there is a negative 1.5% reaction around the project announcement for projects being announced by SOEs only. Now, if you look at the average reaction of SOEs, this number is negative, but statistically indistinguishable from zero. So all of this negative reaction is only happening during election years and for projects being announced by SOEs. So we could come up with a back of the envelope calculation of the cost of such politically motivated investments. So what we do here is say on an average there is 17% jump in the number of projects being announced. So the base is 100. In election year, they announced, say, 117 projects. So we consider those 17 to be politically motivated. The average market reaction is 1.5%. We know the average market cap. That gives us some number. Now, you have to be careful in interpreting these numbers. In all likelihood, this is going to be a lower bound. Why is it going to be a lower bound? Because we take the base as non-politically motivated. To the extent that even non-election year investments, some of it may be politically motivated, this number, the 17% number underrepresents the actual extent of political motivation. And to some extent, the market is not fooled. So we expect them to engage in this behavior. So some of those behavior is already priced into the stock prices. So this is only the surprise component. So the actual value is going to be larger. So this is for one election, 2009. The average market cap lost based on our assumption is $12.6 billion or 2.6% of the mass market cap of all listed government-owned firms. So finally, do voters reward the incumbent politicians for this? The evidence seems to favor that. So if you look at current investments, controlling for the election outcome in the previous elections, each additional project by an SOC in a district leads to a 2.4% gain in the margin of, or the vote share of the incumbents as compared to the opposition parties. So that is a substantial jump. Finally, we look at the channels. So what are these kind of projects? So these tend to be investment projects or projects that will generate, these are based on ex post measures, high employment growth going forward in future. We do not claim any causality here. This is just suggestive evidence if you were to care about channels. Our tests are robust too, as I mentioned earlier, to alternate measures. We can look at cost, we can look at fixed investments, the announcement returns. What we showed is a three-day window around the election. It's okay even if we do it a 5-day window or a 7-day window, different forms of excess returns. So to conclude, this is the first paper to analyze the role of political influence on investments made by SOEs. We showed that it impacts both the timing and the location of investments. And such investments are negative NPV projects. So they destroy market value. So the key takeaway is that political interference has real consequences. SOE investments are subject to political capture. And politically driven investments are value destroying. Now, personally, I am not sure whether they actually even create any social welfare or private firms can do a better job of doing whatever they do. And for whatever reasons, all Indian governments, irrespective of whether you label them as right of center or left of center, all tend to believe that we can turn around PSUs and make them profitable and go back. And again, it goes back to this political capture. So thank you.
Thank you, Shashwat, for this good insight and for keeping up to the time also in starting the first presentation of the day. I'd like to request Dr. Vaidyan to present his views as the discussant. Thank you.
Thank you for a wonderful presentation. I greatly enjoyed reading the paper. This took me back quite a few years because many years back I had also worked on political budget cycles. So it gave me a chance to get back to that literature a little bit. Now, so what do they aim to do, the authors? The paper aims to evaluate the role of political influence on investment decisions of state-owned enterprises. And what do they find? They claim that they find compelling evidence of political investment cycles in the corporate investment decisions of state-owned firms. I Googled this term. Political investment cycles, and you could make a claim that this is one of the only papers where such a term has been used. So, now, the empirical work is all very well, though I will have a little bit to say about it towards the end of my comments. But after reading the paper, I felt that there is one question that is hanging in the air. And that is, why should elected representatives attempt to influence investment decisions by state-owned enterprises? Now, seems to be an obvious question. I mean, you know, so maybe it has an intuitive answer, and as all of us know, intuition is rather dangerous. Up in the air, you could say that they just want to maximize the probability of being re-elected. Now, but notice that such an argument can be made for almost any variable, right? So, but this proposition does not have a theoretical basis as yet. you do not have a well-articulated model actually telling you that this is going to be an optimal strategy. Okay, and but the theoretical model that you actually have says something entirely different. So, like I said, politicians influencing some variable, some expenditure or tax or whatever it is in the budget, this is a very, very loose argument, right? So we need to be a little more careful when we start making claims. And I'll just quote Rogoff. This is a paper that you quote, okay? A political budget cycle arises here due to temporary information asymmetries about the incumbent leader's competence in administrating the public good production process. The incumbent leader has an incentive to bias pre-election fiscal policy towards easily observed consumption expenditure and away from government investment. Okay, so in an extremely well-articulated model, which is hugely quoted in this literature, you actually have a prediction saying that this is exactly that shouldn't happen. You should actually see a huge shift towards consumption expenditures and almost a drop in investment expenditures. Right now, such a prediction is coming out of a fully articulated model. Notice that operations of non-financial public enterprises owned by the central and state governments are incorporated in the analysis of fiscal policy either in relation to the business cycle or elections, because these are likely to have substantial fiscal implications. So I am not convinced that when you are talking about SOVs, you are not talking about fiscal policy. Okay, expenditure via SOVs is actually a part of fiscal policy. Because if these SOEs are really very profitable firms, that has revenue implications for either the center or state governments. If they are hugely loss-making firms, through the budget, the state has to make allocations so that these firms can stay alive and do whatever they are doing, okay? So this is very clearly a subset of fiscal policy. Okay, in the business cycle and in the election analysis of budgets, this has been distinctly realized in the literature, and most people add this to the budget to see what is happening either over the cycle or in dates surrounding an election. So I am a little skeptical about this, that you are taking a very, very segmented view of the entire signaling mechanism that happens during an election. By focusing only on state-owned enterprises, you are just leaving out a huge amount of signaling that happens via the budget itself. Okay? All right. So, looking at data on state-owned enterprises alone is likely to provide a rather incomplete view of the entire signaling mechanism in which incumbent leaders could use to influence voters. Now, in any case, promises of better infrastructure or employment opportunities in the future are very unlikely to influence voters. Okay, now I'm sticking basically to the Rogoff framework. Okay, any expenditure that has a more immediate impact on voter well-being would obviously be a better bet to influence voter behavior. Now, you're making an announcement, you're making a promise of something that is going to happen in the future. There is nothing in the paper that tells me why is it likely to influence voter behavior. Okay, well, when we have well-known theoretical results which tell you that the politician is better off trying to influence voter behavior by actually doling out money, or whatever, via the budget, okay? Loans or whatever, but But promises of the future are problematic. It is highly unlikely that a mere announcement of a project would influence voter behavior unless one endows the voter with some kind of irrationality. Okay, and why do I say this? Because inordinate project delays and projects not taking off at all are a rather common phenomenon in India, and this is not only about public sector undertakings. Okay, this happens in the private sector as well. That is, huge announcements are made about, take the nano car for example. I mean, there could be a huge number of, where an announcement really has no meaning, you know, when it is going to happen, whether it is going to happen at all, there is a huge question mark. Okay, maybe less so in the private sector and more so in the public sector, but you know, this is not so uncommon. In fact, CAPEX itself, you could try and see what are the outcomes and what are the promises. And though I have not done this, but I suspect that there's going to be a huge difference in promises made and outcomes. So this goes back to the argument, you know, somehow the reader is not convinced as to what is the mechanism through which, okay, investment decisions or investment announcements are actually going to influence voters. When I look at the theory tells me something entirely different, that they're going to cut back on investments and make more current expenditures, okay? But now you are making a claim that in empirics you are finding that they are shifting expenditures to, or at least making announcements of investments. So you need to help us with this, a little bit of understatement of how exactly or why you believe this is going to happen. Okay. Now, you use the CAPEX database. I have looked at this database a very long time back, so I mean, what improvements they have made over time is something that I'm not aware of. We do not subscribe to it in IJIDR, so I was not able to actually look at it. But so what is unclear is whether this database includes project implemented departmentally, typically by the public works departments at the state level, or let us say by the railways, where there could be many departments which could do this, which has absolutely nothing to do with state-owned enterprises. Okay. Now, if it doesn't, now I don't know whether it does, but if it does, then my argument doesn't hold really. Okay. But if it doesn't, see, the other problem is that the authors provide no description at all about the nature of projects. This is a major lacuna that needs to be addressed. You need to have at least some description. The reader should get some idea, what are the kind of projects? I mean, infrastructure is really up in the air, okay? There is just a catch-all word which doesn't mean, I mean, it could be roads, it could be bridges, or what? I mean, you know, railways, electricity, hospitals. I mean, what is it? Okay, so maybe a little bit of description of what are the kind of projects that you are talking about. Now, if the data does not track investments made through the PWD or, for example, the railways, then obviously its coverage is not good enough. Okay, you are just missing out on a huge amount of expenditure. Okay, investment expenditure that actually happens. Okay, and clearly, anything that is spent by the PWD or the railways has huge political undertones. Okay, even trains from which station to which station new trains are going to run are actually a political statement, and election year effects can be obviously seen out there. So, does this include, because it doesn't or it does? It does, I mean, all, but what about the expenditures through PWD? Because in the state, I mean, you know, PWD is the one of the main. No, but this is not expenditure that is going to come under any state-owned enterprise. No, whether the cycle shows up or not is a different thing.
No, but that is
what is the coverage of the data is more important, because you see, if you leave out some things which are likely to be significant, then the force of the analysis really drops quite substantially. Because
I'll respond later.
Okay.
To that.
Fine. No. So, you know, this is a question of fact which can be very easily dealt with. I'm almost done. Okay. Now, the panel data covers so many projects. Okay. Now, in 2001, India had 593 districts. I hope I have this number right, which rose to around 640 in 2011. I really hope I have this number right as well. Now, why am I quoting this? Clearly, a very large number of districts do not figure in the sample. Okay, now there could be two reasons for this. Are these districts dropped because there were no announcements in these districts, or because it was difficult to match electoral constituencies to districts? Now there are two things that could happen here. You cannot match electoral constituencies to districts because we know that they are different, or there are no announcements in these districts. So I got a little confused as to how this happens. I mean, moreover, out of a total of 24,000 announcements, you are using only 18,000. You are really throwing away a lot. Now, I can understand that this is happening because of this matching problem, as far as I could try and figure out as to why is there such an enormous loss of data, okay, 24 to 18, and if you think about it, 19, let us say, if you think about it, it's a huge amount of data that has just dropped out, okay? Operationally, I understand that it is difficult when it comes to such matchings, and a lot of things can happen in which you are forced to kind of throw away a lot of data. But throwing away data is a problem, okay? In any case, this unobserved component is likely to be large, I mean, given the amounts that are here. And possibly for this reason, I would be a little skeptical about the empirical results report. Now, you can convince me otherwise, but this is a, all right. In section 5.3, the authors undertake a sort of an event study, okay? Well, it is well known that test statistics used in such studies are quite sensitive to outliers, given that the sample sizes are typically small. You have slightly larger sample sizes, but that's okay. Some non-parametrics need to be reported. Yeah. I'm almost done. Very small event window. If there is going to be a huge leakage, and this is leakage is guaranteed. These are state-owned enterprises. These are politicians. There are no secrets here. Okay, so you can guarantee a leakage when it comes to such projects. When you are guaranteeing a leakage, you need to have larger windows. So I don't know where this event study is really going. Okay. Confounding effects you have not controlled for, so that is another thing. Okay. All right. Now, you know, the Rogoff conclusion that this may not necessarily be a bad thing. That if you prevent people from signaling, they will use other methods which may be even more costly. Okay. So, thank you.
Shashwat.
Yeah.
Should I leave the? Leave that open for the question answers to be taken.
Let me
respond.
A lot of let me respond first.
That's right. Let's take a few questions and
so
you can respond.
Can I answer this question? I'll forget what I thought about and then maybe. There are
because
bunch of things
continue.
I need to.
It will continue. We have the next session to be taken. We've already run a bit.
No, so then
over
I'll take
time.
Maybe 2 minutes and then I'll take the questions. So I can sum up those.
Just take 2-3 questions. It
okay,
may be
sure.
Repetitive and or you
sure.
can club them together and answer them. Yes, Rajeshwari.
Hi, Shashwat. I thought the paper was very interesting. Very interesting question. I liked some of the results as well. And I think there's a lot of room to flesh it out even better. So just one suggestion, and because Professor Vaidya mentioned the case of nano projects. And so one thing that might be worth looking at, you know, a lot of times the election cycle, political parties are announcing projects, but then they don't complete it. And nano is a glaring example. So for example, today if Mamata Banerjee or TMC announces another project, the credibility and the voters are going to take it. There's going to be some discounting of the fact that the nano was a disaster. So past record of political parties announcing projects through SOEs and then not being able to complete it, as opposed to Gujarat, where the Tata Nano went, even when it was not announced. So some interplay of that, which may be very unique in the Indian landscape, would be very important in influencing the voter decision when it comes to voting for that party. So I think if there's any chance of accounting for that in the analysis, that'll be very interesting. Thank you.
Any other? Yes.
Thanks for the presentation. A couple of very quick questions. So first of all, if you're looking at state elections, then there may be certain enterprises which are owned by the center, and say there's an opposition party which is there in the state. So I'm wondering what influence do they have in influencing investments. So I'm guessing there could also be a case where it's the opposition in the state, which is say ruling in the center, which is leading the investment decision. So it's not just the incumbent, but even the opposition, even in cases where the election is not very close. Just wondering if that's been factored. And secondly, there's been a host of social welfare legislation in the past few years, especially with the UPA one, you know, right to food, cash transfers, employment guarantee, and so on. So I'm just wondering if that kind of cash transfer dwarfs political investment in through state-owned enterprises.
Regarding your first question,
Shashwat, we have just 2 minutes, and you respond to these questions. And
Regarding your first question, we have done that. Maybe we can discuss it later. So we have done all of the center, state, whether it's opposition, whether it's the same. Regarding the second aspect, so I want to be clear. So our goal in this paper is not about just political fiscal cycle or political budget cycles. It's to specifically claim that politicians influence investment of SOEs. And to that extent, we exploit cycles to show that. It's an empirical tool to causally show that politicians are influencing SOEs. And there are a bunch of other stuff they can do. They can do cash transfers, a lot of other fiscal policies that they could change. But our goal in this paper is to show political influence and whether it is inefficient as it pertains to SOEs or not, not to make a larger claim about political budget cycles. So theoretically, all your points are very well taken. We have thought about some of these issues, what could be the underlying channel. As you said, this is the first paper that actually demonstrates it. In subsequent papers, we'll try to flesh out why this is happening, what are the voters gaining in response to it. A large number of your empirical claims, I can sum it all together. If anything, leaving out the other aspects of it is we are underestimating the effect, not overestimating it. So when it comes to causality, we are being actually conservative. So we have looked at 3-day window, 5-day window, 7-day window, for instance. If there were to be leakage, as I mentioned, we will underestimate the stock price reaction, not overestimate it. If we were leaving out certain projects, again, we are going to underestimate it. Now, unobservables. Unobservables is not always an issue. You have to tell me a story why the unobserved component has to matter or be correlated with the independent variable that I'm trying to capture. Unless it affects the independent variable, unless it doesn't cause any omitted variable bias, my claim about causality is not hampered. But we need to think more about the theoretical aspects of it, and maybe in subsequent versions or subsequent papers, we'll do a better job of dealing with that.
Thank you, Shashwat. Thank you, Dr. Vaidya, for your comments.